Education and Control, University of Oxford, Department of Computer Science. So Alessandro was in several places before he Oxford, like for example, he did research at SRI and Stanford University, and he was an assistant professor at Delft Center for Systems and Control. And he received his laureate degree from University of Padua and a MS and PhD from UC Berkeley. Alessandro's research interests lie on the analysis, verification, and optimal control of heterogeneous and complex dynamical models, in particular of stochastic hybrid systems. Today he's going to, control, optimal control, and reinforcement learning are very, very closely tied to each other. So Alessandro is going to tell us more about this topic today. So Alessandro, you are muted, so you have to unmute yourself. So the floor is yours.
There you go. Yeah. Can you guys hear me? Can you see my screen?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Oh, good. Yeah, thank you. So thank you for setting up this nice seminar. And it's nice to be back to Berkeley, at least virtually. my contribution actually dovetails quite nicely to what we've seen earlier from Juspita and from Kim. And I'm going to talk about automated verification and control synthesis of complex models. And I'll be referring to models that indeed are quite related to what Kim has been discussing in the previous half hour. We're all familiar with the successes of formal methods in proving the correctness of many systems of interest, such as protocols, hardware, or software, which is by and large done by developing models for these systems, such as finite state machines, encoding perhaps in a temporal logic what correctness is, and then developing model-based, automated, and sound tools and algorithms to provide guarantees, formal certificates, on whether or not the model of the system verifies the encoded correct behavior. The reality is different, though. We have lots of data that comes from sensors, which are ever cheaper and better at processing data. And we have lots of advances in sensing, networking, and embedded computation. So nowadays, complex systems are broadly embedded within an environment that they sense, they learn from, they update their internal models based on. And so the fundamental question is, what is the role of proofs that we can generate from formal methods in the context of embedded complex systems, such as the cyber-physical systems that Kim was talking about? So broadly, what I'm interested in my group is essentially integrate techniques from machine learning. Think of, for instance, Bayesian inference within model-based verification and control to make it, say, for example, time or data dependent or adaptive to data. Or dually, providing certificates for machine learning algorithms, such as reinforcement learning. This is a broad topic that I've been working on for the past few years. So learning for verification and control, or dually certified learning. This is actually not what I'm gonna talk about today, but I would invite you to maybe look into what my group has been working on over these sort of connection between machine learning and formal methods and control theory. What instead I'm going to talk about today is a different dimension of a different challenge, a different dimension of complexity, which is working with complex models such as cyber-physical systems. And in particular, I'll be referring to models with uncertainty, stochastic models. I would like to verify them or certify control policies for them. And I'll be doing it via formal abstractions, which are techniques that have been discussed both by Juspita and Kim. So this is a kind of historical line of work that I started quite naively when I was a PhD student at Berkeley, and that I've been working on over the past 10 years or so. So what are examples of these complex models I'm interested in? So here's an example. It's a smart building, and it's actually a number of teaching rooms in the computer science department at Oxford. So these rooms are highly sensorized. We have access to actuators. This is done through building management system software, and we're measuring these quantities within the rooms, occupants, temperature, CO2, humidity, and we control, of course, the heating, the ventilation via models, right? Models that are updated as data comes in, right? So we need good models that are adapted to data, and we want to verify what we predict, or we want to certify what we synthesize, the actions that we synthesize, in particular, to control these quantities of interest, to do fault tolerance, certified control, to do model-based predictive maintenance of devices, or perhaps if you think of a collection of buildings to do demand response, that is optimized and reliable scheduling of energy usage, as well as of energy storage if you're producing some energy, perhaps with renewables. So these are the kind of problems that we're interested in, alongside other safety critical applications. So what are the models that we work with? So here's an example of what they call a complex model. And this is actually quite close to the class of models that the Kim was discussing, these Euclidean MDPs. So here we deal with models that are hybrid. That is, they have a dual structure, both discrete components and continuous variables. So the discrete component in this case study is this four-state automaton that encompasses whether we are in a room that is empty or full. Empty corresponds to the bottom row, full corresponds to the top row of this four-state automaton. It's actually a simple Markov chain. As you see, probabilities relating the transitions in between these four states. Then we can have whether doors and windows are open or closed. So open are the two states on the right, and closed are the two states on the left, right? So the configuration of these two discrete variables, E and C, characterize the behavior over continuous variables. We have two continuous variables, X and Y, which you see here at the top of the slide. And they model the concentration of CO2 and the temperature in the room. And not only the concentration at a certain point in time, but the evolution of this concentrations as time goes. In this talk, I'll be talking about discrete time models. So here you see indices K, K plus one, which correspond to current time and the next time. So in particular, for example, you see here Y, the temperature at the next time step, and I think here the sample time is 15 minutes, is a function of the temperature at the current time plus something else that depends indeed on where I am on this discrete four-state automaton. In particular, you can see that this parameter mu depends, is sort of a leakage parameter, to say how the internal temperature in the room is connected to the outside temperature. And of course, this leakage depends on whether doors and windows are open or closed, right? It also depends on this resistance, that the walls have in exchanging heat with the outside. Then the evolution of temperature the next time step depends on whether occupants are in the room or not. So this is an indicator function, and it depends on the heat that is generated by these occupants. It depends on whether we are circulating air within the room. Here there's an indicator function that says whether, and this is my control, in fact, whether the air is flowing in or not. And the air can be hot or cold. In particular, you have a set temperature that you're trying to track, essentially, with your current temperature. And then everything is noisy. So you have the dynamics at the next time step are perturbed by some, say, for example, Gaussian random noise. Similarly, for the dynamics of the CO2 level. So the CO2 level at the next time step is a linear function of the CO2 at the current step. And then you have similar behavior that is affected by whether you're circulating air, whether the doors and the windows are open or closed, and whether there's occupants or not. And actually, the two variables, the CO2 level and the temperature, are coupled, right? So there's some coupling between these dynamics. So these are the kind of models that that we're dealing with. These are also known as stochastic hybrid models. They're stochastic because they're noisy, and they're hybrid because you have that the evolution of your continuous variables depends on the configuration of discrete ones, okay? So closely related to the models that, that Kim introduced in the previous slide. Any questions? All, everyone with me? Everyone happy?
Just a question. So where is the control again? Could you say where is it you can exercise the control again?
The control in this case is very simple. It's it deals with air circulation. And it's this variable here in blue. So you can circulate air or not. So it's a binary control. It's discrete control. In general, you can steer these stochastic difference equation with continuous control, if you wish, but not in this case study. These are, let me emphasize, discrete time models. We can also apply the techniques that I'll be discussing to continuous time models, so in particular to stochastic differential equations, slightly trickier, particularly on a measure theoretical level, but as well as on a computational level, actually, because you have to discretize time and make sure that everything converges, that you can provide certificates, error bounds, as I'll be discussing later. I'm not going to deal with these more complicated continuous time models in the next 10 slides.
Just a question, Alessandro, since you were asking for it. So what is the diagram on the right? I mean, that automaton, the hybrid automaton.
It's just a simple four-state Markov chain. Imagine that you start in the morning with the room empty and with the windows and doors closed. Then with a certain probability, within the next 15 minutes, you're still there. Or with another probability, you have that people occupy the room. In which case you go over this top left mode, which is when the room is full, the pupils have come in, and the doors and the windows are closed. And with a set of probability, you can actually open the windows or maybe have the room that is vacated because of an earthquake.
If you're in the Bay Area. If you would make it a Markov decision process, you would have to add the actions.
You might as well add the actions on these finite state Markov chain. Indeed.
Okay.
Yes. Right. So you can affect, for example, the probability that within the next 15 minutes you may open or close the windows. Mm-hmm. Right. Okay. Much like the actions that act on these continuous variables. Mm-hmm. So essentially, these models can be very general. And very rich. Great. So here are simulations of these models, and so we encompass these models with this sort of setup that comprises finite space Markov chains, much like what Jos Peter has discussed. So here you have a finite state space and dynamics that are fully characterized by a transition probability matrix. You may have actions, in which case you have an MDP. But also uncountable space Markov processes, which is what Kim was discussing with his Euclidean MDPs, where the state space is a Euclidean domain, R2. In Kim's case, you had RK. And where the transition probability is not a matrix anymore, but it's actually a continuous kernel. So here's the density of a Gaussian kernel, right? And as much as the transition probability matrix for Markov chains characterizes the probability of going from one state to a set of discrete states, the continuous kernel tells you what is the probability to jump from any continuous point in the domain to any properly measurable, indeed Borel measurable, set A. And you obtain this probability by marginalizing this kernel over this set A. Okay? So these are the kind of models that I work on. They can be, of course, generalized to, as I said, continuous time models. The semantics change completely. But you can have, for example, game theoretical setups where rather than having just one action, you may have, say, a couple of actions And you may have some information exchange between the two agents and set up games that can be collaborative or competitive, right? So modulo details, you can also deal with these more complicated models in the context of the techniques that I'll be presenting in this in the next 9 slides. Right, so what kind of properties are we interested in? In general, we deal with PCTL formulae. These are formulae that encompass, well, that I suppose also Peter used. As an example, let's focus on the simplest of them all, which is probabilistic safety. Namely, computing over, say, a finite time horizon of n plus one steps, the probability that an execution started at any point in the state space S stays within a set A during this time horizon. So here's a formula for this. Now, if you set a probability threshold P, you are interested in coming up with a subset of the state space, possibly the hybrid state space that I introduced in the previous slide, that correspond to trajectories that are safe with a probability greater than or equal to P. Or equivalently, that are unsafe with a probability less than or equal to 1 minus P. So I want to suggest that this probabilistic safety can be expressed with this PCTL formula, which has this bounded until operator, has a negation of a label that is associated with the safe states, not A. It has a true atomic proposition, of course, and then has the complement of this P threshold that I introduced before, right? In fact, you can describe more complicated requirements on stochastic hybrid models with these PCTL formula, or you can think of PLTL formula. In particular, you can use automata. This is something that we have dealt with in literature a few years ago already. Now, you can fully characterize this probabilistic safety, even for complex models like stochastic hybrid systems. You can even optimize over probabilistic safety. That is, if you have an action, a policy, whether continuous or discrete, whether acting on continuous variables or discrete variables, you can maximize, for example, the probability of being safe. The issue is actually to compute these probabilistic safety and to compute this subset, S of P, that I introduced before. Or indeed, to actually compute policies that optimize this quantity, right? So how do we go about computing these quantities or these policies is what I'm going to discuss next. And I want to start with a brief idea that goes back to what Peter discussed in the context of CGIS synthesis, and also what Kim discussed with his refinement approach. So this is what I call formal abstractions. Assume you're given a complex model like the one that I introduced and a specification like probabilistic safety or any PCTL formula. It's difficult to compute this quantity like subsets, but you want to do it in a way that is automated. In order to do that, you provide what I call the xi-quantitative abstractions, which you can think of an abstract model. In fact, as I'll be discussing, these will be finite Markov chains or finite MDPs with a metric xi, which encompasses the error that you make in the abstraction. Now, I will tell you what this metric is or what metrics might be for stochastic hybrid systems and for PCTL formula, in particular probabilistic safety, in the next few slides. Now, imagine that you have this metric. You want to use it in the context of the given specification. So you want to tighten it according to the error that you make, according to this metric xi that you've computed to quantify the quality of your abstraction. Given the modified specification and the abstract model, the Markov chain or the MDP finite state, I should say, that you've obtained, you feed them to a model checker. Say, for example, Storm or maybe Prism, your favorite model checker. And out comes an assertion that says whether or not the modified specification holds. Or perhaps you may want to synthesize a policy over this abstract model. And out comes a policy that is, say, for example, a deterministic map from the abstract states to the abstract actions. This allows you to refine the results whenever possible to the concrete complex model, arguing in particular that the original specification holds, or perhaps that you can have now a policy for the concrete complex model. Often, for example, the error that you make is too large and you can't quite align it with your specification, this automated verification is not possible, in which case you may want to tune your abstraction, refine the abstraction, to use a word that the Kim used, in a way that is automated. In particular, come up with an abstract model that perhaps has a larger cardinality, number of abstract states, that is sort of closer, that is that doesn't have a big error when compared to the concrete complex model. Now, in the next few slides, I'd like to tell you how to compute these abstractions in a way that hopefully scales, that isn't as naive as you might think. And I want to do it for stochastic models over probabilistic safety. So imagine that you're given a stochastic process, and imagine for simplicity that you don't have a hybrid component. So in particular, you might be interested just in a stochastic process that dwells over this set here at the bottom of the slide, right? So two-dimensional rectangle, very simple. You want to approximate it as a finite state Markov chain comprising the set of states S and a transition probability matrix T, right? So how do we do it? We do it by partitioning the state.
So you're abstracting time here, yes? So
no, time is discrete, and I stick with that time. I don't have to touch that. If I had continuous time, then I would need to discretize time, which is possible to do. So I'll hint at that maybe later. Now, how is the finite set of abstract states generated? Well, it's done by partitioning the concrete state space, right? With non-overlapping partition of arbitrary size, okay? In particular, then, you select a representative concrete points within each of these partitions. And these concrete points actually comprise the finite number of states in your abstraction. If this rectangle is your safe set, then you may have an extra state for the complement, which is the set of unsafe states in the concrete model. How is the finite transition probability matrix generated? Well, you condition your concrete kernel, this Gaussian kernel, for example, that I described over the past few slides, over the representative points that you've selected arbitrarily within the partitions, and you marginalize this kernel over the partitioning sets. Evidently, if you compute this over all partitions, this normalizes to rows that sum up to one, and that generates your transition probability matrix. If you have actions, you can obtain an MDP rather than just a Markov chain. In particular, if your actions are continuous, well, I'm afraid that you have also to partition your action space. Now, I know that you think, well, this is not going to scale, but hold your horses, because I'll try to convince you that, well, whilst this is not a panacea, I'm not going to be able to deal with very high-dimensional state spaces. This actually can scale to reasonably sized models by doing partition in a way that is sequential and adaptive. In order to introduce this, I need to tell you actually how to synthesize these metrics that quantify how precise your abstraction is. These metrics that provide an error, it's a one-step error that we make on these finite partitions. So this is what I'm going to do now, and I want to zoom in on the probabilistic safety property that I introduced before, right? And how I would use such formal abstractions to model check, for example, a concrete stochastic hybrid model. So assume that you're given your safe set within your state space, a finite time horizon N. I'll discuss extensions to unbounded time horizons later, and a safety level P. Assume that you abstract your concrete model with a finite Markov chain so that your safe set A is now a set of points, which I call A delta. Delta is a parameter of your partition. So for example, the diameter of the partition set, the max diameter of the partition set. And let's assume that you can quantify the error that you've introduced in this abstraction. I'll tell you what this error is in the next slide. So assume that you know this Xi error. This is the metric Xi that I introduced, that I discussed before. This error intuitively will depend on how fine the partitions are. Delta is the diameter of these partitions, and N is the time horizon. So it will be monotonic as a function of N. Now, remember that we wanted to compute the subset of a PCL formula, in particular of this probabilistic safety requirement, which is a set of points in the state space that are unsafe with a probability less than or equal to 1 minus p, right? Now, I want to suggest, and I'm leaving lots of maths on the side, that this subset can be approximated with the subset that you can compute with a model checker over the finite space Markov chain that you've generated according to this PCTL formula. You recognize this PCTL formula because I discussed it earlier in one of the previous slides. What is different now is that I'm applying it on the complement of the set of discrete states that I've obtained from the abstraction, not a delta. And I'm computing it not with a complement of the safety level P, but actually with a tightened requirement, y minus p minus xi, where xi is the error that I've made in the abstraction, which depends on these delta and n quantities that I've discussed before. So this is the idea of generating this metric, this error on the abstraction, that you use to tighten the concrete formula, the PCTL safety formula, into a sort of tighter, more conservative formula that then you use with a model checker, Storm or Prism, over the finite abstraction Markov chain that you've generated. So the takeaway point from this slide is that this difficult to compute subset over the concrete model can be approximated by this easy to compute, or rather automatically computed subset over the finite abstraction. Now, I haven't told you what this error is. I just assumed that I know how to compute it. And in the next slide, I'll tell you what this error is and how we can compute it. And in fact, this error can be quantified for any PCTL formula you may want to throw at me, even nested ones, if you're careful. And in fact, also for infinite horizon ones, as I'll be hinting at. So we need some assumptions on how to compute this error, and we need some continuity assumptions on the kernels. So assume that the density of the kernel, which I denote as small t, is continuous, namely Lipschitz continuous. Lipschitz continuity is a continuity that is characterized by a constant h, and that tells you how essentially perturbations over the densities are upper bounded in errors. Now, if the kernels are indeed Lipschitz continuous, then we can come up with a one-step error that we make with the Markov chain that we generated over the concrete model, one time-step error. This one time-step error depends on this Lipschitz constant h. It depends on the max diameter of the partitioning set. And then it depends on the volume of interest, the volume of the safe set, say. Now, this is an interesting error because it can be tuned by selecting the diameter of the partitions, right? So in particular, smaller partitions will correspond to smaller one-step errors. It's an interesting error because it also relates to the notion of approximate probabilistic bisimulation, which is a notion that incidentally Kim worked on a few decades ago and that has been discussed by many in the literature, whether for finite Markov chains or whether for stochastic processes. In particular, you know, we mentioned the labeled Markov processes. So Prakash Panagaden has been working on these probabilistic by simulation metrics. So this is a notion of approximate probabilistic by simulation that actually, you know, we can easily compute as a side product of R abstractions. So you can think of R abstractions as approximate probabilistic by simulations of the concrete stochastic hybrid models. Now, if your formula is an n-step formula, so in particular, if you work on n-step probabilistic safety, then you take your one-step error, and through telescopic results, you can just argue that the n-step error is n times epsilon, right? So if your formula is a bounded horizon, then this is fine. This error can be extended also to infinite horizon formulae, in which case, well, evidently, this linear dependence doesn't work. But we can find a sort of negative exponential growth formula through techniques from probability theory that we can apply to these approximate probabilistic by simulations. And in fact, this error that I've introduced for probabilistic safety can be tailored to other PCTL formulae, or even errors that you make over richer nested PCTL or formulae expressed as a PLTL. Now, we can generate these finite abstractions with software tools. The first one that I worked on is called Faust Square. Faust is not just the Goethe character, but actually is an acronym that stands for finite abstraction of uncountable state stochastic processes. It generates these abstractions in a way that is sequential and adaptive through an anytime algorithm. That is an algorithm that you can stop and sort of distill out to your abstraction and the corresponding error anytime. So it starts with a very naive and rough abstraction that is easy to generate. It computes the error that you make over a given formula. It checks whether this error is meaningful to do this tightening of the formula and this verification over the abstractly generated model. If it's successful, then you're done. Otherwise, it keeps on refining the abstraction and it keeps on reducing the associated error. This is kind of like a Seeger loop, except we aren't using counterexamples. We use the matrix that we generate over the abstractions, this error matrix that I introduced, which is tailored to any formula that is given, to generate these abstractions in a way that is sequential, adaptive, and that can be stopped anytime, perhaps when you run out of patience or memory. And as much as sort of error-based abstractions have been encompassed in this tool, we've also worked on a newer tool. This is from a couple of years ago, where actually we use these abstractions within interval-based. We use this error within interval-based abstractions, much in the flare of what Kim introduced. So this tool is called Stokey. It's been presented at TACUS19, I think. And actually, it also handles continuous time models, where we have to discretize not only the space, not only the action spaces, but also time, of course. So these are the kind of tools that we've developed. There's newer tools that have been distilled by Cognate literature that exploit modularity, other assumptions on the dynamics. So if I have some time, I'd like to show you some outputs from the use.
Actually, you kind of need to wrap up.
Run out, yeah. So this is just back to the case study that I introduced before. I wanted to just show you the kind of results that we generate. So these probability of a refined formula that we can compute for any possible point, concrete point in the hybrid state space of the stochastic model. And that's the output that I just wanted to discuss. Many thanks for your attention and your patience. If there's any time left, I'll be happy to take questions.
We could take a short question does anybody want to raise a question?
I have a short question.
All right, go ahead.
Please.
Data. You are expert also on this thing with, these models that we have, they should be calibrated with the data that you observe. Like, can you say, how does that interplay with this approximation you have there? Because you have the uncertainty of your model because it's only based on the observation of the data, and then you have an additional uncertainty due to the partitioning. Or how do you see it? I think that requires a long answer. I'm sorry.
Yeah. So this will require another couple of seminars, perhaps. So I'm keen to integrate data in the context of stochastic models with Bayesian reasoning, Bayesian inference, which needs to be, of course, applied in approximate versions. So approximate Bayesian computation. I use sequential Monte Carlo techniques to update probability distributions over parameters of the models, which can be used in the context of finite abstractions that I've been discussing today. Doing that in real time, much like what you have discussed, is not there yet. But per se, the way that I would integrate data in the context of these models is with the Bayesian inference.
All right. Thank you very much. I now give the
thanks for your attention
floor to Ružica to introduce our last speaker. Thank you very much.